The theme of our session is the future of democracy. The future of democracy is relating to a best understanding the past, the history of democracy. Why I appreciate the idea of Gary to formulate this session, foundation of democracy. In yesterday's session of Board of Trustees, I insisted we need to rebirth the culture of democracy, because now the problem is not the failure of democratic institutions, but the failure of democratic conscience, including situation in Western democracy and also in the United States. And in this situation, we need to come back to study experience of transition from dictatorship regime in Central Southeastern Europe to democratic regimes about 30 years ago. Why we need to insist about some theoretical aspect, but also a practical aspect of this transition. According to Popper, democracy is moral, as is it, it permits a change of governments without bloodshed. The 1989-1990 People's Movement is a concept proving that in the age of pragmatism and consumerism, the moral imperative may transcend democracy, which is thus precedes and follows. The events of 1989-1990 proved that the totalitarian regimes become powerless when tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, and even millions of people subject to isolation in different countries and communities simultaneously rush out into the street, not for economic or social claims, but for freedom, truth, and justice. Such regime collapse when their most dependable weapon, the fear of the oppressed, is even temporarily overcome by faith. Those who, like myself, went out and marched in the street can testify to Popper and later on Havel developed the idea of the morality of democracy, a framework wherein by changing the world, we change yourself and become able to accept your own errors. Starting from this idea, we can clearly discriminate between the pro-democratic movement in 1989-1990 and the leftist and rightist pro-totalitarian extremist movement that tragically marked in the first part of the 20th century the destiny of the same countries and peoples. It is the difference between fanaticism and the courage to fight for the everlasting values of man. This offers a key to the peaceful character of all of the East European changes. The communist regimes, once overthrown, the moral foundation of the change was going to become a source of risk. The management of hope is difficult. Enthusiasm has always been a perishable resource in history, especially when the difference between ideals and illusions shows and the responsibility for the latter is thrown upon the other. Under these circumstances, the rhetoric of success has rapidly been replaced by the rhetoric of failure. And after a very brief period of euphoria, the end of history, the blow came from where we least expected it. From the Western intellectual elite, they replaced optimism by a somber state of pessimistic anxiety. If I'm asked it today, what the bound of the democracy is, I answer without the slightest hesitation. A pluralist system represented by powerful parties with well-structured ideologies, able to ensure an alternation to power, and a civic society able to control the power, whichever it would be. These firmas could seem strange for a person who comes from university environment without being a member of the party, like me. My stand is a result of the experience acquired during my entire life in a totalitarian regime and during about 3 decades of transition towards democracy. The anti-communist dissidents in Central and Southeastern Europe and the huge popular movements in the end of the 8th decade of the past century were built with the slogans, free elections, a democratic constitution, freedom of mass media. The reality after the collapse of communist dictatorship has shown us that what we leveled up to meet were necessary but not sufficient conditions for real democracy. Moreover, we have soon realized that they were used with ability of the former communist nomenclature and by the former political power that put into stage an imitation of democracy. The new democratic construction, free election, and the part of free mass media have become tools of promoting the interest of the new oligarchy still informing. The experience of the former communist countries in the Central and Southeastern Europe illustrates the fact that democratic constitution with no support from active democratic institutions, political parties, civic associations, and restricted only to the act of governing do not lead to political freedom. The transition towards democracy had to confront with a mentality generated in communist time by a dissolution of individual political liberty into people's power and into national consensus. The psychology of the masses was prepared for introducing a new saving leader with the society. The temptation of a presidential regime which to apply direct democracy by referendum prepared by populist messages corresponding with a collective mentality. The representative democracy could be killed in the act. Long before communism, Oscar Wilde had understood that the power of people could mean cudgeling people by and for the people. And unexpected difficulty in developing the political project of the transition came from the superposing in time of the collapse of East European communist dictatorship and of a theoretical controversy which left a mark at philosophical level on the end of the 20th century. This is about the controversy between monist modernism and postmodernist pluralism, or more exactly about the controversy between the proponents of similitude politics and those of difference politics. Left-wing ideology was based upon similitude politics, generated by common consciousness that would derive from the affiliation of the same social class. The class politics ruled out the differences of sex, race, and ethnic, and froze the potential conflicts without ever solving them. On the other part, postmodernist excess also excluded the appeal to human nature, to ration or to moral law, which is fundamental for the spiritual and moral rebirth, but exaggerated the difference politics for groups smaller and smaller and contradictory the West shows us how it could come to what Roth mentioned as indifference politics. This is why the reconstruction of political parties as pillar of pluralist representative democracy was necessary in order to counteract both the integrator tendencies of the totalitarian left or right wing ideologies and the tendency of excessive crumbling of postmodernism. Birth of rebirth of political party was fundamental for creation of the representative democracy and for the reinforcement of the state institutions, but the straightening of the parties as a risk of transformation of democracy into particracy with negative effects on the process of strengthening the democracy. A new effort from the civil society is necessary in order to impose a correct relation with a citizen upon political parties.
Thank you.